So the next question is, the statement not of P implies not of Q is logically equivalent to which of the following, which of the statements below? So we have P implies Q, Q implies P, not of P or not of Q or P, and not of P or Q. So which of these are equivalent to this? Okay, so let's see. We have not of P implies not of Q, and we know that contrapositive of a proposition is same as preposition. If you have P implies Q, this is same as not of Q implies not of P. So this is contrapositive of P implies Q, and the truth table of P implies Q and not of P, not of Q implies not of P is same. So we can say not of P implies not of Q is equivalent to its contrapositive, and contrapositive of not of P implies not of Q will be not of Q implies not of P, that is Q implies P. So one of the option, that is second, is correct. Now let's see how we can write not of P implies Q. If we have something like this, P implies Q, we can write this not of P or Q, okay, to remove the implication. So we can write not of P implies not of Q as not of P or not of Q, or you can say P or not of Q. So these two are equivalent to this position, not of P implies not of Q. So P or not of Q, P or not of Q. So second and third are equivalent to this, that is option D is correct. Second and third are equivalent to this. So we have next question, and this question is saying, consider the first order logic sentence F, that is for all X that exist Y, RXY. Assuming non-empty logical domains, which of the sentences below are implied by F? So we have for all X there exist Y such that RXY is true. So if RXY is true for all X, that means it is already true for at least one value. So this can be written, we can also write like this, there exist X, there exist Y, RXY. Okay, we can write like this. This is subset of this, but we cannot write there exist X as for all X. Okay, this is one way theorem. For all X can be written to there exist X. Okay, there exists at least one value, and this RXY can be true for all values, but there exists at least one value. If it is true for all values, that means it is already true for at least one value. So option A is matching, that is there exists X, there exist Y, RXY, and you can write this like this, there exist Y, there exist X, RXY. Okay, we can write this like this. So option A is matching with this, there exist Y, there exist X for RXY. So if I apply not on this, let's say option 4. Okay, let's look at the option number 4. There exist there exist X for all Y, not of RXY. So if I apply this not inside this bracket, what this will happen? So we have not of there exist X for all Y, not of RXY. Okay, so if I apply not to this, then existential quantifier will become universal quantifier. That means this will become for all X. Now not will come here, and it will make universal quantifier to existential quantifier, and this will become not of RXY, which means simply RXY. So this is similar to our logical sentence, okay, first order logic sentence. So definitely 4 is also same as for all X there exist Y, RXY. If I apply not twice, so second is saying there exist Y for all X, RXY. Okay, can I write like this? I have already given there exist Y, or for all X there exist Y, so I cannot replace them. If I have something like this, for all X there exist Y, I cannot change the order. If I have something like this, for all X, for all Y, RXY, then definitely I can change the order. I can change order like this, for all Y. The order of quantifiers can be changed in case of universal quantifier. But in case of one existential quantifier and one universal quantifier, I cannot change the order. In this, what it is doing is it is changing the order. Okay, there exists y for all x. This is not true. Then third is saying for all y there exists x, but y is only there exists at least one value. Okay, so we cannot write there exists y as for all x, for all y. This cannot be written, but we can write for all y implies there exists y. Okay, this can be written. So option 3 is also wrong. So first and fourth are true. So B is the right answer, first and four. Okay, this is first and four. So option B is correct for this question, that is first and fourth. So next question is, consider the following functions from positive integers to real numbers. Arrangement of the above function in increasing order of asymptotic complexity is. So we have 10, root n, n, log base 2 n, and 100 by n. So we have to arrange them in the increasing order. Increasing order means first we have to write smallest value, then second smallest, then third smallest, and then largest value, like this. Okay, so to compare all these functions, I need to take a large enough value of n. Okay, if I take n less than 10, then this 10 will become larger than this 100 by n. Okay, 100 by n will be larger than 10, but because 10 is constant and this is variant, so this value may be 100 by n may be less than 10. Okay, how? Let's take n value that is large enough value. Okay, 1024, large enough value to compare. So 10 root n will be 1024. Then n is 1024, log base 2 in log base 2 1024, and 100 by 1024. So this is 10, this will be 2 to the power 10, which means root of 2 to the power 10 will be 2 to the power 5. This is 2 to the power 10, and this will be 10. Log base 2, 2 to the power 10 will be 10, and then we have 100 by n. That is 100 by 1024, which is less than 1 value. Okay, less than 1, which is smallest value actually. So first we will have 100 by n, which is the smallest value. Then we will have 10 log base 2 n, which is actually 32. Okay, log base 2 n is 10. Then we will have log base 2 n. Then root n, and root n is always greater than log base 2 n. Then largest value is n. Okay, so n is largest value, root n is second largest value, log base 2 n is third largest, and 10 is fourth largest, and 100 by n is smallest value. Okay, for the large value of n, this will lead to very small value. Okay, so the order is like this: 100 by n, 10, log base 2 n, root n, and we have 100 by n, 10, log base 2 n, and then root n, n. Okay, 100, 10, log base 2 n, root n, and n. So option B is correct for this question. Now we have next question, and in this we have three algorithms, PQR, that is Kruskal algorithm, Quickshot algorithm, and Flawed Virtual algorithm. Kruskal algorithm is used to find the minimum spanning tree with the help of using greedy algorithms. Quickshot is a divide and conquer algorithm which divides the array into two parts according to the pivot element. Okay, so this is divide and conquer approach of sorting the elements. Flawed virtual technique is a dynamic programming technique for all pair shortest path. Okay, so Kruskal algorithm is matching with greedy approach. Quickshot is divide and conquer approach, and flawed virtual is dynamic programming approach. That is, P is matching with 2, Q is matching with 1, and R is matching with 3rd. So answer is 2, 1, 3. That is 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 3. That is C. C is the right answer for this question. So next question is, let T be a binary search tree with 15 nodes, the minimum and maximum possible height of H, height of tree T, The height of a tree with a single node is 0. Always remember, height starts with 0. So it is being asked minimum and maximum height of a tree with 15 nodes. So we have 15 nodes. So minimum height means to get the minimum height, we have to fill the maximum nodes at each level. Okay, to get the minimum height, you need to fill all the levels fully. Okay, so it will be perfectly balanced tree. Okay, if in case of minimum height, we want a perfect binary tree in which all the internal nodes are full till the last node. For example, if I have 15 nodes, this will give minimum height. So I will have a tree like this, in which I will have 15 nodes. This is my tree with 15 nodes. Okay, and this is height 0, this is height 1, this is height 2, and this is height 3. So minimum height is 3. Okay, or you can directly find the height by using the formula. In the perfectly tree, log base 2 n plus 1 minus 1. Okay, this is the formula to find the minimum height. And a tree will give maximum height when we have minimum nodes at each level. So whenever we want to find the maximum height, we have to keep the minimum nodes at each level, each height. If you want to find the minimum height, then you have to keep maximum nodes at each level. That's how I have kept maximum nodes at each level. Okay, because this is binary tree, so I'm keeping 2 nodes. I can keep at most 2 nodes, 2 children of a node. So we have all maximum nodes at each level to find the minimum height of a tree. To find the maximum height, what you need to do is you need to keep the minimum nodes at each height. Okay, for example, minimum can be 1. Then minimum can be 1. We cannot keep 0, we can keep 1 or 2, but I want to take minimum, so I can take 1 node at each level. If I take 0 nodes at any level, this will be disconnected, okay, and tree cannot be disconnected. So this will be like this, we will have 15 nodes like this. So we will have like this 15 nodes, and this will be height 0, this will be height 1, this will be height 2. And like this, at 15th nodes, we will have height equals to 14 because this is starting with 0. So maximum height is definitely n minus 1. N minus 1 is the maximum height of a binary tree, and log base 2 n plus 1 minus 1 is the minimum height of a binary tree. So to get the minimum height, you need to fill the maximum nodes at each level. To get the maximum height, you need to fill the minimum nodes at each level like this. So minimum height can be 3. And maximum can be 14. So 3 and 14 is the answer for this question, that is B. So next question is, the n bit fixed representation of a unsigned real number x uses f bits for fraction part and remaining I bits for the integer part. Okay, I equals to n minus 1 and minus f. The range of decimal value of x in this representation is what? So we have a n bit fixed point representation of a binary number, of a unsigned real number. These are the n bits, and out of these n bits we have a fraction part and integer part. Let's say this is your integer part, this is fraction part. Fraction part, the length of fraction part is f, and remaining n minus f bits are used for integer representation. Okay, so let's take an example of 8 bits. Let's say I have an 8 bit representation in which I have 3 bits for fraction part and I have 5 bits for integer parts. Okay, so to get minimum value, what I need to do is, minimum value will be when all values are 0, when they all of them are 0. So this will be the minimum value. Fraction part as well as integer part will be 0. This will be minimum value, that is 0. 0 will be the minimum value. For maximum value, what I need to do is, I need to keep all of them 1. Okay, if I want maximum value, then I need to keep all of them 1. So maximum value will be like this. 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay, and 1, 1, 1. This will be maximum value. So I need to find the range. Range means what we mean by range? Range means minimum to maximum value. Okay. So we have minimum value 0, and what now we need to find maximum value. What will be the maximum value? For example, if I have a 4-bit number, for example, let's say I have a 4-bit integer, and 4-bit integer can be 0.00.00, which means let's say I have 2-bit integer part and 2-bit fractional part. This will be 0. Okay. If I want maximum value, what will be the maximum value in this case? 11.11. I can write this like this: 11.11 into 2 to the power minus 2. Okay, this is fraction part. Or I can say, if I want to find the maximum value, this can be 2 to the power n minus 1. Okay, let's say these are the 4 bits. I can represent with these 4 bits, I can represent 2 to the power n minus 1 values. Okay, this is 2 to the power n minus values. I am generalizing this formula. How? These are the 4 bits. Okay, now I have total number of 4 bits are n. Okay, n is 4 bits. We have 4 bits, and I can represent 2 to the power n minus 1 value with these 4 bits. Maximum I can represent 2 to the power n minus 1. This is 15. 1111 is 15. So I can represent 15 with 4 bit number. And this is into 2 to the power minus 2, which means this is divided by 2 to the power minus f. Okay, because fraction part is 2. This is fraction part. Fraction part is of 2 bits. I can write this like this: 1111 divided by 2 to the power 2. Okay, so this will be 2 to the power plus 2. Okay, because this is in denominator. So I can say like this: if I take this 2 to the power f on the upside, I can write like this: 2 to the power f into 2 to the power minus f into 2 to the power n minus 1. Or you can say 2 to the power minus f into 2 to the power n minus, I'm multiplying this 2 to the power minus f inside this. This will be 2 to the power minus f. Or you can say 2 to the power, this will be n minus 1, n minus f. 2 to the power n minus f to minus 2 to the power minus f. And we know that n minus f is I. Okay, so I can write like this: 2 to the power I to 2 to the power minus f. Okay, so we can find the maximum value like this. I have 4 bit number, and from these 4 bit numbers I have 2 bit integer part and 2 bit floating point part. I can write this number as 1111 into 2 to the power minus 2. So, and you can write like this: 1111 divided by 2 to the power 2, that is, this is minus 2. So like this I can generalize the formula from this example, and the value, the minimum, the range will be 0 to 2 to the power I minus 2 to the power minus f. Okay, this is minus 2 to the power I minus 2 to the power minus f. So the correct answer for this question is 0 to 2 to the power I minus 2 to the power minus f, that is D. So D is the right option for this answer, for this question. Then we have this next question. We have a code in which we have a structure node int data and node star next. This is a node of a linked list. It is given and it has two parts, that is data and next part. Next part is a pointer which is pointing to the next part of next node. Void node, void join, node star m, node star m, node star p equals to n. So I have taken n value to a pointer p, while p next is not equals to null, p equals to p next. And then after reaching the next, what you need to do is you need to link p next part to m. So I am passing two values, that is m and n. And what I am doing is I am expanding this node n to list m. Okay, I am expanding this n node to the last of this m list. As you can see, p is taking the pointer n and p is reaching to the last of list n. Okay, so I am appending m list to the end of the n list. Okay, what I am doing is, first in this loop, what I am doing is I am reaching to the end of this list. Okay, p next is not equals to null. Until p next is not equals to null, keep doing the p equals to p next. Okay, and p is taking the pointer n. Okay, pointer n is pointing to the list, to the start of a list n. So I have passed this pointer to P, and P is going to next, and going reaching the last of the list. After reaching the last of the list, it is appending M to the last of list N. So M is appended to the last of list N. So option A is saying append list M to the end of list N for all inputs. Either cause a null pointer reference or append list M to the end of the list. Cause a null pointer reference, append list N to the end of list M for all inputs. So, and it is saying that M and N point to valid null terminated linked list. Null terminated linked list means all the links are terminating with null. Okay. So we have passing two lists, M list and N list. We are reaching to the end of the N list, and after reaching the end of the N list, we are appending M. So definitely we are appending M. So option is saying append list M to the end of list N for all inputs. This is true. Either cause a null pointer dereference or append list M to the end of the list N. Cause a null pointer reference for all inputs. Okay, this is not true. Append list N to the end of list M. We are not appending N to the end of M. Actually, we are appending M to the end of N. So one of the option is true. So this option, this is suitable option. Option B. Why? Because we can pass list N as null. If we are passing N as null, then what will happen? If we are passing M as null, what will happen is we will try to join a list with the null list, which will cause a null pointer dereference. Okay, so in this case option B is true, which is also possible. It is possible to cause a null pointer dereference in joining these two lists. So next is question number 20. So in this question, productions are given like this: S tends to AB, SCT and ABC, then T tends to BT or B. So these two productions are given, and we have to find the language corresponding to this grammar. So we can write like this: S tends to AB, and we can replace S with ABC, and this is T. Okay, ABCT. So we can replace S with ABCT like this: ABC, T, and then CT. Okay, remaining CT. So next, what I can do is I can replace AB. I can replace T with the BT, and T with the BT like this, and I can have AB C. Let's say T tends to BT, then CBT tends to B. Okay, let's say T tends to BT, and then I can have S tends to AB AB C BB B, and CBB BT. Okay, or you can say AB ABC BB B C BB BB. So I can have the strings like this, which means we will have AB to the power N, and then we will have C, and we can have any number of B's, and then C, then any number of B's. So let's look at the options: AB to the power N, CB to the power N. This means this is saying CBs are coming in pairs. Okay, this is not possible because CBs are not in pairs. So this is wrong. AB to the power N, CB to the power M1, CB to the power M2, CB to the power N, and MN of all the M's are different. This is true, in which B, here we have 3 B's, which means the value of M1 is 3, the value of M2 is 4. So we can have different M's. We can have like this: B to the power M2, where M1 is 3, here M2 is 4. So we can have like this. Okay, any number of B's followed by C. Then we can, option 3 is AB to the power N, CB to the power M to the power N. This is not true. We do not have CB to the power M N, though. So CB is not occurring in pairs. Then this is saying AB to the power N, CB to the power N, M. This is saying AB and C, AB and B are same. Okay, this is saying the number of AB and B are same. This is not true. So correct option is B, which is matching this string. Okay, so we can generate a lot of string from this grammar, and we can check by looking at the strings. So this is the language for this grammar, option B. Next we have question number 24, and in this question a code is given like this: struct data int marks 100 char grid and int c numbers. So we have an object of this structure, that is a student. So this structure is like this. We have a structure in which we have three parts, that is marks, then we have grade, and then we have number, C number. And marks itself is an array, okay, is an array of 100 elements. We have 100 elements in this array, okay, like this. So how we can access this? Asking the base address of a student is available. The base address of this structure is available in R1. The field student.grade, I want to access this field, can be accessed efficiently using which of the instructions? So definitely all of the data types are not of the same type, okay, they are differing in the size, which means marks is of 200 bytes, okay, because int takes 2 bytes and we have an array of 100 integers which will take 200 bytes, okay, it will take 200 bytes. And then we have grade will take 1 byte, and we have int c number which will take 2 bytes. So I cannot use, because R1 is base address. If you increment the base address, you will be incremented by a fixed size, okay, let's say for 2 bytes or 4 bytes, but you cannot reach grade by just incrementing the base address. You cannot use pre-increment, pre-decrement, or you cannot use register direct addressing mode. We cannot use register direct mode. Register direct mode will give the base address. Okay, we cannot access the grade using the base address, but we can access grade by using the base address and offset. Okay, I need the offset of this address. So index addressing mode XR1, where X is an offset representation, 2's complement, 16-bit representation. So R1 is base register and X is offset. So by adding offset to the base register, what I will find, I will have the value, I will have an address on which we can use index addressing mode to access grade. So grade will have an offset address which I can use to add with base address to find this value. For example, if you have an array like this and the base address of this array is 1000, okay, base address is 1000 and you want to access this element. So you should have offset. Offset means this is, let's say, index A2, and each element is of 2 bytes. So the offset of this will be 4. Okay, offset will be 4. So I can add this 4 to base address to reach this correct element. Okay, that's how I can do in the structure. So I can access grade, marks.grade, using the index addressing mode by using the base address and offset of grade. So option D is correct for this question. Next we have this question. Consider the following intermediate program in 3 address code. So we have a program in 3 address code, and this question is from compiler. Which of the following corresponds to static single assignment? In static single assignment, what we do is we try to assign a unique variable to each of the variables in the high level language. For example, I have p equals to a minus b. These are the variables. We have 3 addresses, 1, 2, 3. In 3 address code, we have 3 addresses, and 3 addresses can be represented in static single assignment, and this static single assignment will be used for the purpose of code optimization. We can do the code optimization after doing the static single assignment. Static single assignment means give single name to each, give unique name to each variable, okay, each kind of variable. And q equals to p into c, you need to see which variable is used where and which is updated. P equals to u into v, and then q equals to p plus q, which means this p and this q and this p is used here, and this q is new. This p is used as an input to q. So what I can do is I can give names like this, p1 equals to a1 minus b1. Then I can say, or I can simply say p1 equals to a minus b, because a is unique, a is not used anywhere. So I can say p1 equals to a minus b. I have to give the unique name to only those variables which are repeated. Okay, which are repeated. For example, p, q are repeated, so I can give unique names to them. So p1 equals to a minus b. Then I can say q1 equals to, because q is coming for first time, and I'm using this p as an input to this on the right hand side. So I will be using this p1 into c. Okay, C is for the first time, so I will not rename this. Then P. So this P is not same as this P. This P is again updated with the new value. Okay, this P was updated with A minus P and this P is updated with U into V. So I have to keep a new name, a unique name for this variable. Let's say P2. P2 equals to U into V. And then Q. So this Q and this Q is different. This Q is updated by P into C and this Q is updated by updated value of P and Q. So I can say this is Q2 and Q2 equals to P1, this one and Q1. Okay, sorry, Q1 and P2. That is P2 plus Q1. Okay, so this is using, this Q is using the updated value of P and Q. And this P was P2, so I'm using P2 here. And then this Q was Q1, so I'm using Q1 here. So the static, the which one of the following correspond to a static single assignment? So we have P1 equals to A minus B, this is okay. Q1 equals to P1 into C, this is okay. But P1, this is not same as this P1, so this is not true. This will be P2. This is saying P3 equals to A minus B, Q4 equals to P3 into C, this is true. This P3 is used here. And then this is P4 equals to U into V. We have to use different P, this position, okay, this is like this. P3 equals to A minus B. If I write these options, I can rewrite these options like this. Q4 equals to P3 into C for the clarification. And P4 equals to U into V. And Q5 equals to P4 plus Q4. Okay. So this is okay. P3 equals to A minus B. P3 equals to A minus B. This is name is different. Okay. I have taken the name different names and it is taking different names. P3 equals to A minus B. Then Q4 equals to P3 into C. This is also okay. This P3 is being used here. Then P4. I have to take different P from this. Okay. I have taken different P. This is okay. Then Q5. I have to take different Q from here. And I'm using P4 and Q4 as an input to this. So P4, Q4 is okay. So this option is okay. Let's say P1 equals to A minus B. Q1 equals to P2 into C. This is a problem in this option. Because this Q, this Q is using the P which was used here. Okay, the updated P is being used as an input to Q. But in this Q1, this P, this is using new P which is not available. So this is wrong. Then this is P1 equals to A minus B, Q1 equals to P into C. Okay, this P into C, this is the problem here. This should be P1 into C. That's why this option is also false. So option 2 is correct for this question, in which we are giving a static single assignment for each code. So P, second option is correct. Question number 23. Consider the following C code. We have a code like this. Int, we have this function star assign value, int star x int value, star x equals to value and return x. Okay, remember this, we are returning a local variable. Void main, we are assigning a dynamic memory to x. Okay, we are allocating memory dynamically. If x equals, if null equals to x, then return. If well, if any memory is not allocated to x, then return. Otherwise, x equals to function call assign value x with 0. Okay, if x is non-zero, that means true, then we execute this code. X equals to int is int star malloc size of int. If null equals to x, return x equals to assign value x10 and printf percent dn x free x. So this is asking, options are saying, compiler error as the return of the malloc is not typecast appropriately. This is not true. Compiler error because the comparison should be made as x equals to null and not as shown. This is not true. We can also compare like this, null equals to x. This is also valid. Compile successfully. This is true. This will compile successfully, but execution may result in dangling pointer. Compiles successfully, but execution may result in memory leak. So one of these options is true. What is it is technical. We have dangling pointer in this or memory leak. We have to see this. Okay. What is dangling pointer? So we have dangling pointer and memory leak. What are these two concepts? So first let's look at these two concepts, then we can answer the question. Dangling pointer means point to a memory location that has already been freed. If you are pointing to any location that has already been freed, that means you are pointing to a null location. Okay, so there is a dangling pointer problem. So this is point to a memory, if you are pointing to a memory that has already been freed, so this is the definition of dangling pointer. For example, we have a function, let's say char star, and this function is returning a pointer, and then we have a string in this function that is of length 10. So I am copying something to this string. Let's say I am copying hello to this string, and in the end this function will return a pointer. Okay, let's say I am returning the base address of this pointer, this string. Okay, that's the return string. So you are returning a local variable to a function main. So when you will return this function main, this function will be popped off the stack and this location will not be available. Okay, and main is having a pointer to a string. Okay, you are pointing to a string, but string is not available in memory. So this is the problem of dangling pointer. Okay, so you are returning an address which was a local variable, which would have gone out of scope by the time control was returned to the calling function. Main was calling this function and control has returned. If called control has returned, this means this function is not available in the stack, in the activation record. So this memory is not available which you are pointing. So this is the problem of dangling pointer. You are actually returning the pointer to a local variable. And what is memory leak? A memory leak is a memory which hasn't been freed. There is no way to access it. Okay, as there are no ways to get it to anyone anymore. For example, let's say we have a dynamic allocation of a memory. Let's say we have char star ch, and ch is assigned a memory which is dynamically. Okay, char star, I am allocating memory dynamically 10 bytes like this. And I have not freed this memory. Okay, ch was assigned dynamic memory and this memory was not freed, and after the return of this function, this memory, this ch will still point to this memory location, because this is in heap, this is not in stack, this is in heap. So ch will still point to this location, but we cannot reach ch anymore because we have returned from the function. So this is memory leak. This is the case of memory leak. If you are assigning memory dynamically, it is your responsibility to free this memory. Okay, in case of C, automatic garbage collection is not available. You have to free the dynamic allocated memory yourself by using the free function, free x. Okay, so how this code is related to these two concepts, dangling pointer and memory leak. So let's look at this code one by one, line by line. So we are returning a local variable, then void main int star x, but this is not a x is not a local variable. Actually x is passed by reference. Okay, so there is no problem of dangling pointer here. Int star x equals to malloc size of int. We have allocated malloc size of int to x. If x equals to equals to null, return, otherwise point x to the value which is returned by this function. Okay, assign x value. Assign value is returning a pointer, and x is pointing to that pointer which is being returned by assign value. If x equals to int star malloc size of int, if x equals to x, if null equals to x, return, otherwise assign, call this function assign value x10, which will return a pointer to x, and this pointer, and then x is pointing to this pointer. Printf %d x star x free x. So what is happening is, in this pointer x is pointing to this location, then it is pointing to some different location. Okay, x equals to sign value. So x was pointing to this location, and now you have changed the assignment. You have changed the assignment of x, which means this location is still there. This memory is still there in heap. The size of int is still in the heap, and you have removed the pointer from this location. So there is a memory leak in here. There is a memory leak, which because you cannot free this memory. This memory was allocated dynamically and you cannot free this memory anymore because now x is pointing to a different pointer. As you can see here, now we have allocated the memory dynamically, and then we are assigning x to a different value. Okay, this assign value is this a function call. So x is pointing to some other function, some other address now. So initially it was pointing to a memory location which was allocated dynamically, Now X is pointing to some other location. So here is also a memory leak. Okay. So this complete code is actually suffering from the memory leak. We have allocated dynamic memory dynamically many times, but we have not freed. We have freed only one time. Okay, we are freeing X, which is actually pointing to assign value X, and this assign value method is returning a pointer. Okay, so free X is actually freeing that memory which was returned by this assign value method, which it is not freeing that value which was actually dynamically allocated. So there is a memory leak in this function. So option D is correct for this question. Question number 24 says, consider a TCP client and a TCP server running on two different machines. After completing data transfer, the TCP client calls the close to terminate the connection, and a fin segment is sent to the TCP server from the TCP client. Server side TCP responds by sending an acknowledgement to this frame fin, which is received by the client side TCP as per the TCP connection state diagram. In which state does the client side TCP connection wait for the fin from the servers? So when we close the connection, actually connection establishment and tear down is like this. Let's say this is client and this is server. So initially we create a connection in the way of three handshake. It will send fin, and then looking at the fin, server will send fin plus acknowledgement. This means client is saying I want to connect, server is saying I have received your request and I also want to connect. So at this stage client is established, client is in the state of established, then it will send acknowledgement to its fin segment. Okay, so it will send acknowledgement. This means server is also in established state now. Now after sending some data, it will try to tear down the connection, it will try to close the connection. So client will say I want to close the connection through the fin segment. So after sending the fin, the server will send acknowledgement. So this is the situation given in the question. After sending the fin frame, client will come in a state that will be called fin wait 1. Okay, so the client will be in this stage from here. So after receiving the acknowledgement, it will change the state and it will go into the fin wait 2. Okay, fin wait 2. So it will wait for the fin segment from the server, because let's say server has some data to still send. So server will send all the data, and after sending all the data, it will say I also want to close. Okay, so it will say acknowledgement, it will say fin. So in this case, client is saying I want to close the connection, fin. Server will say okay, I have received your request for close the connection. It will send acknowledgement. Now it will go into the fin wait 2 state, and it will wait for the fin segment from the server. After sending the fin, when the server send the fin segment to client, now it will change the state to time wait. Okay, now finally it will acknowledge to the server that I have received your fin segment. Okay, this will send the acknowledgement. So in this period, server will be in the last acknowledgement state. Okay, in this time duration, server will be in close wait. And finally it will be closed. So this is the way how connection is established and connection is closed. In this scenario, it is saying TCP server side TCP responds by sending an acknowledgement, which means this is the condition till now, which is received by the client side TCP. So TCP client side TCP has received this acknowledgement as per the TCP connection state diagram, which is this. In which state does the client side TCP connection wait for the fin from the server? So it will wait in the fin wait 2 state after receiving the acknowledgement. Now it is waiting in the fin wait 2 state for the fin segment. Okay, after receiving the fin segment, it will change the state from fin wait 2 to time wait. So the option 4 is true for this question, fin wait 2. Question number 25 says a sender S sends a message M to receiver R which is digitally signed by S with its private key. In this scenario, one or more of the following security violation can take place. S can launch a birthday attack to replace M with a fraudulent message. A third party attacker can launch a birthday attack to replace M with a fraud message. R can launch a birthday attack to replace M with a fraud message. So what is birthday attack? What is birthday attack? First we need to see this. Birthday attack is nothing but sending fraud message. In birthday attack, what we do is we send the fraud message with same hash value. With same hash value as of the original message. Original message along with the digital signature. Of the original message. So this is called the birthday attack, in which we are sending a fraud message with the same hash value as of this original message along with the digital signature of the original message. We can use digital signature in two ways, either for only authentication. We can use digital signature for authentication, and we can use digital signature for authentication and secrecy. If you want to use this digital signature for authentication and secrecy, what you need to do is you need to use public key cryptography. For authentication and secrecy, you need to use public key cryptography, in which what we do is first we encrypt the message with the sender's private key and then receiver's public key. Okay, what we do is first we will apply the, let's say we have sender and this is the sender's private key. First we will apply sender's private key on the message, and then we will apply the public key of the receiver. Okay, public key of the receiver. First we will do the encryption using the private key of sender and then public key of the receiver. If you are using this for only authentication, then you simply need to encrypt this message with the private key of the sender. Okay, you do not need to use public key of the receiver. But if you are using your digital signature for authentication and secrecy, what you need to do is you need to sign this message digitally using the private key of sender and public key of the receiver. So, but how birthday, who can attack this message using the birthday attack? Anyone who is having the private key of the sender can attack this. Okay, and we know that private key can only sender can have the private key. Let's say a middle third party attacker, third party sitting between sender and receiver, can have only public key of both the parties, but cannot have the private key of one of the parties. Or let's say R has a public key of receiver, will have the public key of receiver and the private key of the receiver. So receiver cannot have the private key of the sender. So only one person can attack this message using the birthday attack, that is sender. Okay, only sender can attack this message because we are actually digitally signing the message with the private key of the sender. Okay, we are digitally signing the message by using the private key of the sender. So anyone who is having the sender's private key can send the fraud message with the same hash value and the same digital signature. Okay, only sender can generate the hash value and digital signature because he is having the private key of sender. Okay, and this message can only be generated, this message can only be created encrypted using the sender's private key. So option one is saying S can launch a birthday attack to replace M with a fraudulent message. This is true. S can launch a birthday attack because he is having the private key of himself. Okay, he is having the private key, so he can, what he can do is he can change the message, he can change the content of the message and can generate the same hash value as the original message and can generate the same digital signature as the original message because he is having the private key. A third party attacker can launch a birthday attack to replace M with a fraud message. This is not possible because third party will not have the private key. At most third party can have the public key of both. Okay, and in worst case scenario, third party can have the private key of the receiver. So R can launch a birth attack to replace M with a fraud message. This is not possible because message is encrypted using the private key of the senders. So these two are false. Only one is true. That is option B is true for this question. One only. This question is from database management system and this question is saying the following functional dependencies hold true for the relational schema are V, W, X, Y, Z and we have some functional dependencies V tends to W, V, W tends to X, Y tends to V, X and Y tends to Z. Which of the following is irreducible equivalent for this set of functional dependencies? This is simply asking the minimal cover of this set of functional dependencies. We have V tends to W. And VW tends to X and Y tends to VX and then we have Y tends to Z. What we need to do is we need to remove the extraneous attributes. Okay, extraneous, which attributes are extra to minimize the set of functional dependencies. We want the minimized functional dependency, reducible functional dependency, those functional dependencies which are actually irreducible, which are not more reducible. We can reduce this set of functional dependencies to one of set of functional dependencies which is actually minimal. We cannot reduce we can reduce that more. So how we can replace? Case one is if we have something like this x tends to x, y tends to z and we have a functional dependency x tends to y, what we can do is because x is giving y, we can remove y. Okay, y is itself implied from the x and so y cannot come with x because y is subset of x, y can be implied from the x. So we can write this, if we have two functional dependencies like this, we can write like this, x tends to z and x tends to y. Okay, we can write them like this. So in this case, we have v tends to w and vw tends to x. So these two can be written like this, v tends to w and v tends to x because we have w in the right hand side of the v. So vw cannot come together, so we can actually eliminate w. W is an extraneous attribute. Okay, in this case one, w is extraneous attribute, so v tends to x. Then we have y tends to v and then we have y tends to x. Okay, y tends to x, but x is already declared by v. Okay, x is already given by y, so we can actually eliminate this functional dependency, that is y tends to x, because x is already given by v. So y tends to x can be eliminated, so we will have y tends to v. Then finally y tends to z, this cannot be further reduced. So can we reduce this further? We cannot reduce this further because we do not have any extraneous attribute in this. Okay, we have two extraneous attributes in this, that is y tends to x and w. So after using these extraneous attributes, we will have minimal set of functional dependencies in which we cannot remove more functional dependency. It is now irreducible and this is asking which of the following is irreducible equivalent for this set of functional dependencies. So we can reduce like this using the reducible rules. So options are v tends to w, v tends to x, y tends to v and y tends to z. This is okay. Second is saying v tends to w and w tends to x. So in this what we have done is we have removed v. Okay, we cannot remove v because v is actually giving w. W is not giving v. So this is wrong. Three is saying v tends to w, v tends to x, y tends to v, y tends to x. This is causing the problem. This option is okay, but this is the problem here. Y tends to x cannot be in the irreducible set because we can reduce this. Okay, this is more reducible. So we want a irreducible set. Then we have v tends to w, w tends to x, y tends to v, y tends to z, y tends to z. Okay, y tends to x, y tends to v and then w tends to x, w tends to x and v tends to w. So we cannot use this w tends to x, this should be v tends to x. Okay, so this is also false. So according to options, only option A is true. So option A is answer for this question. Question number 27 says we have this set of p tends to x q r s, q tends to y z z, r tends to w null and s tends to y. We have this grammar and we have to find the follow of q. Okay, follow of q. So follow of q is, as we can see from here, r is followed by r, q r is followed by q, so r will be in the follow of q. So first of R will be in the follow of Q, but in the first of R we have null, so we need to take S, first of S. So we cannot have null in the follow. We can have null in the first of a variable, but we cannot have follow in any variable or terminals, in the follow of any variable or any terminal. So follow of q will be first of r, but first of r is not enough because we have null in the first of r. So that's why we need to take first of s as well. So this will be the follow of q, that is first of r is w and null. Null, we do not include null in the follow. So w and first of s is y. So wi is the follow of q, that is option C. Option C is correct for this question. Question number 28. Threads of a process share what? Global variable but not heap, heap and global variable, neither global variable nor heap, and both global variables and local variables. So when a program is executed and when this program becomes process, operating system creates a process for a program. Okay, when this it is in memory, so process is created like this. We have a exe file which was our program, compiled program, and which is converted to exe. So we will have a exe file here, which is code. Actually in this exe file we have a code, and then we will have all the global variables and static variables accessed by this static and global variables here. And then we will have a heap which will grow upwards, and then we will have a stack which will grow downwards. So these are the component inside a process. This will grow in downwards and this will grow upwards like this. So we do not have a fixed location for the stack and heap, but we have a fixed memory location, fixed size of memory for both stack and heap, okay, combined. But we do not have individual constant on stack and heap, memory allocated to stack or heap. They are variable, okay. If heap goes more, if heap occupies more memory, stack will be given less memory. If stack occupies more memory, then heap will be given less memory. So these are the parts of a process. So thread is nothing but, thread is a lightweight process. It is a part of a process. So which of these are shared by a thread of a process? So thread will definitely will actually share static and global variables and heaps. Okay, so thread will have their own stack, but they will share heap and static and global variables. So option D is saying both heap and global variables are shared. So this is the right answer for this question. Question number 30 says, let T be a tree with 10 vertices. We have 10 vertices in a tree. The sum of the degrees of all the vertices in T is, so sum of degrees is 2e. Okay, 2e is the sum of degrees in any graph, and tree is also a graph with n minus 1 vertices. Okay, in tree we have n minus 1 vertices. We know that in any tree maximum can be n minus 1 vertices. Okay, if we have more than n minus 1 vertices in any tree, it is a cyclic tree. So we cannot have a cycle in the tree, it will be a graph, cyclic graph. So we can have at most n minus 1 vertices in a tree. So sum of degree is 2e, and e is given n minus 1. So number of vertices, the sum of degree of vertices will be 2 into n minus 1, which is 2 into 10 minus 1, that is 18. So 18 is the right answer for this question. This is simple. 18 is the right answer. Question number 31. In this we have a K-map, and this K-map is given like this. DC variables are in this side and BA variables are in this side. Or you can say this is B bar A bar. This is B bar A. This is BA and this is BA bar. And this is D bar C bar. This is D bar C. This is DC and this is DC bar. We can write like this. So we assume all the inputs A, B, C, D, the respective complements A, B, C, D, A bar, B bar, C bar, D bar is also available. So we do not need any NOT gate to actually take them as A complement. A complement, B complement, C complement, D complement are already available to us. The above logic is implemented using two input NOR gate. So the minimum number of gates required to represent this function. Okay, so we can have only one pair in this K-map, that is the pair of 4, this pair. Okay, so we have don't care conditions, we can ignore them. Okay, So this will be in this position we have A bar, B bar, A bar and B A bar. This means A bar is common at this position. And then we have D bar C D C in which C is common. So function is A bar C. So how many NOR gates are required? We can construct this using a single NOR gate. So we can construct using a single NOR gate. How? This is, let's say, this is A and this is C. Okay, and this is your NOR gate. Because complement is already available to you, so you can implement like this. This is A bar plus C whole bar, which means this will become A C bar. So we require only one NOR gate to implement this function. That is, answer is 1 for this question. Next question is, consider the language L equals to A plus B star B A plus B given by the regular expression this. Over the alphabet AB, the smallest number of states, okay, minimum number of states needed in a deterministic finite automata accepting L is what? So we have to find the minimum DFA for this language, and we have to find the number of states in this DFA. So what we can do is, easiest way to find the answer of this question is, we can construct an NFA from this language, and NFA will be like this, and then convert the NFA to DFA. Let's say this is Q0 and we are accepting A plus B star. So this will be A plus B star and then B. Okay, after reading B, we are going to a next state Q1. And then from Q1, we can reaching next step, that is final state by reading either A or B. This is A plus B. Okay, so this is the DFA for the language A plus B star B A plus B. So if you want to draw the transition table from this, transition table will be like this, Q0, Q1, Qf, and we will have two terminals, that is AB. Q0 after reading A is going on Q1, Q0, and Q0 after reading B is going to Q0 and Q1. This is the problem. This is due to this transition, this is NFA. And then Q1 after reading A is going to Qf, and Q1 after reading B is going to Qf. Qf after reading A is not going anywhere. So we can convert this transition table of NFA to DFA transition table using the conversion AB Q0. After looking at the Q0, after Q0 looking at the A is going to Q0. Q0 after looking B is going to Q0, Q1. Then next state will be Q0, Q1. Q0, Q1 after looking at A is going to Q0 and Qf. Q0 is going to Q0 after looking at A. Q1 is going to Qf after looking at A. Then Q0, Q1 on looking B is going to Q0, Q1, Qf. So now we have two more new states. Q0, Qf. Q0, Qf after looking at A is going to Q0. And Q0, Qf after looking at B is going to Q0 and Q1. Okay, Q0 is going to Q0, Q1 after looking at the B, and Qf is not going anywhere. Then we have a next state, new state, that is Q0, Q1, Qf. Q0, Q1 and Qf. Q0, Q1, Qf after looking at A is going to Q0 and Q1. Q0 and Q0 after looking at A is going to Q0, and Q1 after looking at A is going to Qf. And Qf is not going anywhere. Q0, Q1, Qf will go to Q0, Q1, Qf after looking B. So this, there will be four. We do not have any new transition, new state in here. So we can have states, four states in this minimized DFA, and we can draw the DFA like this. We have a state Q0, which is initial state. Then we have a state Q0, Q1. And then we have a state Q0, Qf. And then we have a state Q0, Q1, Qf. Q0 after looking A is going to the self loop A. Q0 after looking B is going to Q0, Q1. Q0, Q1 after looking A is going to Q0, Qf. And Q0, Q1 after looking B is going to Q0, Q1, Qf. then q naught qf after looking a is going to q naught, and q naught qf after looking b is going to q naught q1. Then q naught q1 qf after looking a is going to q naught qf, and q naught q1 qf after looking at b is going to itself, that is self loop. So this is the DFA for this language, and you can draw and q all the states with qf are final states. Okay, all the states with which are having f are final states. So you can find the strings from this language and can try to run those strings on this DFA. So all the strings are accepted by this DFA which are generated by this language. So we have four states in a minimized DFA for this language. So answer is 4 for this question. Next question is, consider a database that has the relations schema employee EMP in which we have attributes employee ID, employee name and department name, and instead of the schema EMP and instance of the schema EMP and SQL query on it are given below. So this is the table which is given and this is the query. So query is like this: select average of ec.num from ec where department name and num in, this is subquery, select department name count employee id as ec depart name and num from employee group by department name. So first we will execute the subquery. So what subquery is saying, select department name and count employee id. So we are selecting as ec department name and num. So we are selecting two attributes from this table, and these two attributes are like this. We have these two attributes, department name and count, and we are selecting these two as department name and num from employee and group by department name. So first this group by will be executed from employee group by department name. So we will have department name which will be grouped, and then we will have num. Okay, we will have two attributes because we in inner query we are selecting two attributes, department name and count. And count is being selected as department name and num. Okay, num is corresponding to count and department name is corresponding to department name. So we have a new table EC which we have selected as a view from this table from employee group by department name. Okay, we have how many groups we have in department name? Department name we have AA, 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 AA. Then we have AB, 3 ABs. Then we have ACs, 3 ACs. Then we have 2 AD and 1 E. So department names are like this: AA, then we have AB, then we have AC, then we have AD and then EE. So these are the departments, and then what we are doing is we are grouping them and then counting. Okay, we are counting the employee IDs in each group. We are counting the employee IDs in each group. Okay, so in group by we will group by department and we will count the number of group employee IDs in each group. So in group A we have 4 IDs, 1 2 3 4. So we have 4 employee IDs in group A, in department A. In department B we have 3 employee IDs, and then in department C we have 3, and in department D we have 2, and in department E AE we have 1. So these are the employee IDs according to groups: department AA, department AB, department AC, department AD and department AE. Then now this inner query is completed. Now outer query will execute. Select average, which means now we will select from this. Select average of EC.num. EC is this table and num is this. Now this means this is talking about this. We are selecting this column from EC, from this table where department name num in. So we will select department name and num from this original table, and then we will match which of the departments and nums are in this inner query. All of these departments are there in the inner query: AA, AB, AC, AD, AE. All of the department names are there in the inner query. So we will select all the departments and the EC.num from department name and num. So we are selecting num from this inner query, and then what we are doing is we are trying to find the average. Okay, average of the count of the old employee IDs. So we have total 4 plus 3 plus 3 plus 2 plus 1. We have this much of employee IDs in each group, and then we are finding the average. So we have 5 groups, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We will divide by 5. So this will be 4 plus 7, 4 plus 3, 7, 7 plus 3, 10, 10 plus 2, 12 and 1, 13. 13 by 5, which means 2.6. So the average, this will select average 2.6. So answer of this query will be 2.6. See, this is simple. What we need to do is, we need to first execute the inner query. And inner query is very simple. It is just selecting two attributes from this outer table. And then one attribute is count of the employee IDs in each group. Then outer query is selecting those department names which are already there in the inner query, department name and num, because department name is already there in the, all the department names are there in the inner queries. So it will select all the department name from the outer queries. Okay. So department name and num are already there. This condition becomes true. So all of the tuples will match and it will select the average of these ec.num. Average of ec.num is like this, 2.6. So the answer to this question is 2.6. Question number 34. In this question, we have CPU processes that arrive with arrival times. These are the arrival times given and these are the bus time for each process. Okay, so we are giving in the primitive shortest remaining time first scheduling algorithm is used to schedule the process, then the average waiting time across all processes, what milliseconds? So we have to find the average waiting time for all the processes combined. And we are using SRTF algorithm, which is primitive algorithm. So first what we need to do is, we need to draw the Gantt chart from this set of process. Let's see how they will execute. So we will start with 0. And process P1 is already, process P1 is there in the ready queue at the time 0. So we will execute P1 and new process will come at time 3. Okay, till 3 it will have executed 3 milliseconds. So they will be subtracted. So we have executed 3 milliseconds of process P1. Now remaining are 4 and new process is coming P2 at time 3 and it is less than the currently executing process. So we will remove this process. So next process will run be P2. Okay, so P2 will run from 3 to 5 and new process will come at the time 5. Arrival time of next process is 5. So this process has run for 2 milliseconds. So now 1 millisecond is remaining and next process is having 5 remaining time. Okay, shortest remaining time is 1. Okay, out of 5, 1, 4, shortest remaining time is 1, which is of P2. So P2 will keep running till 6. Okay, after the completion of 6 seconds, we have 3 process in the ready queue, that is P1. P3 and P4, which P2 is completed. So now we have P1, P3, P4 and shortest remaining time is of P4. So P4 will run from 6 to 8. Now we have 2 process in the ready queue, that is P1 and P3. So P1 is having the shortest remaining time, that is 4. So P1 will run from 8 to 12 and now remaining 17 are 4. 12 to 17, now only one process is remaining, that is P3. So P3 will run from 12 to 17. So like this all process will run. So we have to find the average waiting time. So average waiting time, let's say waiting time for P1 is, initially there is no waiting time for process P1, but now P1 will go into the ready queue at time 3 and it will come back from the ready queue to execution at 8. So 8 minus 3 is 5. Response time minus arrival time is waiting time, that is 5. Then we have waiting time of P2. So P2 has come into ready queue at 3 and we have given CPU to P2 at 3. So there is no waiting time for process P2 because the arrival time of P2 is 3 and the response time of P2 is also 3. So there is no waiting time for P2. Then waiting time of P3 is, P3 has come into ready queue at time 5 millisecond and we have assigned CPU to process P3 at 12. So response time is 12 and the waiting and the arrival time is 5. So waiting time is 7, that is 12 minus 5. Then waiting time of P4. Process P4 has come into the ready queue at time 6 millisecond and we have assigned CPU to process P4 at 6. So there is no waiting time for this process. So total waiting time is 5 plus 0 plus 7 plus 0 and total number of process are 4. So this is average waiting time. So this is 12 by 4, that is 3 ms. 3 ms is the average waiting time for these 4 processes using shortest remaining time algorithm. So answer for this question is 3. So question number 35 says, consider a two-level cache hierarchy with L1 and L2 cache. An application incurs 1.4 memory access per instruction on average. For this application, the miss rate of L1 is, so L1 miss rate is 0.1. The cache experience on average 7 miss per instruction per 1000 instructions. The miss rate of L2, okay, the miss rate of L2, we have a term missing here. The miss rate of L2 expressed correct to 2 decimal places is what? So when there is a miss in the L1 cache, we will go to the L2 cache. Okay, so how we can solve this question? Simply, and it is given that there are 1.4 memory access per instruction and we have total 1000 instructions. Okay, so 1.4 memory access per instruction and total number of instructions are 1000. In 1000 instructions, we will have 1000 into 1.4 memory accesses. So there are total 140. Okay, there are 1400 memory access, total 1400 memory accesses, and we have 7 memory access per 1000 instruction, or you can say 7 misses per 1400 instructions. Okay, we can say like this, and the miss ratio will be, there are 7 miss per 1400 instructions, which means miss ratio is 1/200. Or you can say 0.05. Okay, so this will be 0.05 miss ratio in the L2. Okay, the miss ratio in L2 will be 0.05 and miss ratio in L1 will be 0.1. So the correct answer for this question is 0.05. Okay, that is 0.05.